بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم نحمده ونصلي على رسول الكريم أما بعد. There is a need to leave home, whether it's for masjid, whether it's for work, whether it's for other necessities. So we need to take precautions. The point that we are mentioning is just basic, simple points. But what's more important is for us to do research, to speak to the experts. Each person knows their limitations, they know their environment, they know what they need to do. So we should prepare. So this is just a brief synopsis, a brief treatise of how we can prepare in different situations, as our life is an amanah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we need to protect this amana. Every second of our life is an amana. It is a trust. We need to protect it. We need to preserve it. We need to make sure we utilize it properly. Our health is a trust, is an amana. Every organ in our body is a bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We cannot allow any body to compromise this trust. So one wrong situation and regrets for our entire life. Likewise, shaitan, the biggest enemy, and our nafs, our base desires, is out there to destroy us as well. So like how we are cautious from the thieves of this world, we need to be cautious from the thieves of our year after as well. With regards to preparing, Nooh alayhi salatu wasalam was commanded to build a ship. So people laughed at him, people mocked at him. So he was unwavered. He never relinquished the command of Allah. You need to do what you have to do. Finish. Doesn't matter what people are doing. So to such an extent that even his son didn't believe him. So when the moment came for him to board the ship, what he said, "Sa'awi ila jabalin ya'simuni min al-ma." That I will take refuge in the mountain, it'll protect me from the floods. So even his own son never listened to him because he thought so, his planning was sufficient. But Nooh alayhi salam warned him, and it was told that Allah commanded Nooh alayhi salam and told him that he is not part of your family. La asim al yawm min amri Allah illa man rahim. So Nooh alayhi salam said, there is no savior from the decree of Allah except him on whom Allah has mercy. So no one will be saved today from the command of Allah except those whom Allah has chosen. So وَحَالَ بَيْنَهُمَ الْمَوْجِ, and a wave came between them. فَكَانَ مِنَ الْمُغْرَقِينَ, he was amongst those people who drowned. So a son of a Nabi had yaqeen in his own system, in what he thought was a refuge at that time. So many lessons here. One is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided Nooh alayhi salam with regards to dunya from the worldly harm, from a flood, how to be protected. So people are saying that deen is only deen, it's dry. No. When the people of deen make effort on deen, Allah will open up the things of the dunya. And let's look at the pages of history and see the different fields of expertise and science that the Islamic empire, the Islamic world had given to humanity. So when you have deen, you have amal, then no matter how incapacitated a person is outwardly, Allah will open up, Allah will give a solution for a protection for that person. And once a solution is opened up, we should engage. We shouldn't take it for granted. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will create men in the ummah to guide the ummah. When this guidance comes to our ears, we shouldn't take it lightly. Like the son of Nooh alayhi salam took it lightly and he got caught. Likewise, Nooh alayhi salam made effort for approximately 950 years and only plus minus 80 people accepted his message. So despite him making so much effort, only a few people accepted. So another rule is that the truth may open up to many, but only few will accept it. Then we see the power of dua. لَا تَذَرْ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ مِنَ الْكَافِرِينَ دَيَّارًا. That Nooh alayhi salam could have been taught the art of warfare, he could have taught the art of destruction, etc. But he was given the power of dua. It was so powerful, it wiped out everybody else that didn't accept iman. So the power of dua. So we underestimate deen. We underestimate the power of deen. So the moral of the story is, Nooh alayhi salam did both. Asbab wise he prepared, and amal wise he was also prepared. So we have the extremes, where a person does everything with regards to asbab and means, but the amal, the yaqeen, etc. is very weak, and that may be very detrimental. Then a solution may come in front of a person and it might not make sense. Like Nooh alayhi salam told his followers to board the ship, it didn't make sense, but follow the command, don't use your logic. So in the 21st century, where we are so-called intellectuals and we are modernists, where we want to mold deen according to our mindset and our intellect, there's no options. Follow Allah and His Rasul. Chapter closed. So we need to trust in Allah, we need to trust the men of Allah. Likewise, if asbab-wise, Nooh alayhi salam was never a captain of a ship, he did not know how to steer a ship, he did not know navigation, etc. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made sure the ship reached its destination, they were all saved and protected. So we also know, whatever we can prepare. وَتَوَكَّلْ. Then after that, فَإِذَا عَزَمْتَ فَتَوَكَّلْ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Once Allah has opened up a certain route, do what you need to do with regards to the means, but don't ever lose tawakkul and trust in Allah. So Nooh alayhi salam built the ship, but his trust was still. He could have said, okay, I'm building the ship now, how will I steer the ship? How will I control the ship? Where will the ship go? There's so much objections. Likewise, these people could have objected, we get in the ship, where are we going, what are we going to do, etc. So when we trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then Allah's help comes. But when you get caught thinking and we want to cover it and we think so we got it covered, but we got it covered in the wrong ways because our intellect has surpassed our iman. And that's where iman comes in place. يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Hand your matters over to Allah. وَأُفَوِّذُ أَمْرِي إِلَى اللَّهِ. There's a certain parameter which we can go to. Then it terminates, it ends, it's finished. From that juncture, moving forward, tawakkul starts. So we need to learn tawakkul as well, and not only an asbab. Like they say, there was a man who was telling his friend, who was boasting, my grandfather predicted in advance the very year in which he was going to die. Wow, amazing. What's more, he knew the exact month which he was going to die. Amazing. But he even knew, now he's boasting even further, the precise day he was going to die, even the time of day he was going to die. And you know what? He was right on every count. So his friend said, that's uncanny, that's savage, that's beyond human comprehension. How did he know all of that? How is it possible? Was he gifted? Did he have a sixth sense? What was it? So he replied, the judge told him. So where we are and where we're supposed to be, it's the earth and sky. So preparation, so self-awareness is critical as well, that you yourself as a person, what is your makeup? So you have to know what provokes you, you need to know what prompts you, you need to know what skill of self-defense you have in a situation. Let's take a few examples. What is your physical strength? What is your weaknesses? Do you have any training in self-defense? If you do have training in self-defense, is that sufficient to help you in a situation? Are you just learning different skills which are made for tournaments but not a skill to save your life? Are you in shape? Means you're doing 100 kilos bench presses and you're doing 1,000 burpees. But are you in shape? So a person may be looking like a bodybuilder, but ask him to run for 100 meters, he can't. So if he's faced with a situation where a person is armed, he's not armed, and if he tries to escape, what's the chances of him escaping when he cannot even run 50 meters and be out of breath? So you train 3-4 hours in the gym, you had your fancy diet, you had your fancy trainer, you had your fancy shakes, but did it really shake the situation when you needed it? So we need to be vigilant, we need to be not climatized to what is being sold in the alleys, in the gullies of the world, in the name of making money. So at the end of the day, it's what's going to work for you and your family. Then example, how do you handle stress? So if you are faced with a situation, are you really panic, a stricken person, etc.? Do you get frightened easily? Do you freeze? In your nature, are you likely to aggravate the situation or diffuse the situation? So there's hostility in front of you. How would you react? Are you passive? Are you aggressive? Are you opinionated? Are you a person who can make a call at a certain time? The family's tied up. They put a gun to your head. Tell us, where's the safe? What have you prepared for that? And how geared up are you? So do you have a decoy safe in your house? Are you hot-tempered? So in that situation, if somebody prompts you, are you going to say something that they may pull the trigger? Does your occupation, does your travel route, does your business make you or your family vulnerable to whatever crime it is? So your place, your time, your resources, your circles, your locality, your country, your lifestyle, what does it make you and your family vulnerable? So first important point is that we need to know ourselves. Then interpreting the situation. How good are you in interpreting the situation? So depending on the situation, let's say we hear of an incident. So there was a break-in in the middle of the night in your neighbor's home, and this is what happened. They were tortured and they cleaned them out. So first question you would be asking is, who was attacked? Who was the attacker? What happened? What were the circumstances? Where did it happen? Where did it develop? When was the act committed? Why was the act committed? Why did the perpetrator? Why the victim? Why that particular act? How did they get away? How did they get in? What was done to prevent this from happening? What loopholes, what weakness was there in the system? How was it committed? So we have a situation, we dissect it completely, and then we digest what was dissected by seeing what we need to implement. So every day we build, we get better, we get more vigilant. So it's just not enough, oh, did you hear? No, just, yeah, this person, yeah, in your street. No, it's not all about stories. Otherwise, we'll be the next story. Allah protect one and all. So then some people only worry about themselves. But what about your wife? How skilled she is? What does she, if she's alone in a situation of compromise, what can she do? Your children, in different situations, whether it's a robbery, whether it's firefighting, whether it's first aid, what skills have we given them? So people are very particular to make sure that at a very young age we send our children to school. But the real school of life, have we taught them that? So it's all about our thought process. There was one person who, in every bathroom of his house, he's got wire cutters, he's got a crowbar, he's got a panic button hidden where you can't find it. So I asked him why. He said, if ever everything fails and I get tied up, and they would normally lock you in the bathroom, then there's an escape plan. Wire cutters to cut, whether they used tape or however they bounded me, a crowbar to get out if I need to escape, and a panic button if I need to call for help. So thought processes. Somebody else was building a bunker. So I asked them a few questions. They said they thought of every angle, even of dead bodies. So let's say somebody has to go for a bunker for 1 or 2 or 3 years, which they were preparing for. Somebody in your family becomes deceased, and for some reason, whether it's a nuclear, whether it's turbulence, still that you cannot leave your bunker, and somebody passes away. You cannot go outside, you cannot dig a grave, and you've got only that space. What do you do with it? Marhum. So they've thought of that as well. So how much have we prepared our family as well? So we need to sit down, husband and wife are traveling, are they at home? And if this situation happens, there is an assault. What strategies, what tactics, what methodologies? So we should never ever take life for granted at all. We should never take every day as a day and another day of our life. And let us, because we've become so materialistic, we've become so overwhelmed with the dunya, that we don't really think of things which are very important. So somebody leaves their home, it's a nice sunny day, they're enjoying the cool breeze, they're going to work, etc. But by lunchtime, you could be, Allah protect one and all, in hospital, could be injured, could be dead, never return home. So yes, taqdeer, our death has been written, and our desire is to become shaheed, to die in the path of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But asbab wise, the people of Yemen prepare. So a person prepares for his meals. Why do you go to work? You prepare for your meals, you prepare for your clothing, you prepare for your transport. All of the asbab of dunya we prepare, but we say no, everything else must move on tawakkul. That's double standards. So we need to see, how can we reduce the risk? So risk analysis is very important. So as a person, let's say when you leave the home, you identify where's the vulnerable areas. If it's a woman, for some shari'i udhr, she needs to leave the house. She'll make sure she will not go in isolated areas. She will not pass zones which are red zones. Then when you leave also, what body language, what signal do you emit, so that others that are watching you, they realize this person is confident, they are in control, and we cannot take them by surprise. So you display your vulnerability. So if somebody was a thief, iron out somebody and look for somebody who is stopped, who's busy on the cell phone, who's looking around, who's lost, who counts their money, opens up their wallet, they make it easy visible, their bags are on the side, easy to snatch. They in a daze, they deep in conversation, you're outside your house, what somebody is speaking. But you're really oblivious of the situation. So a car passed once, twice, and you never even noticed it. You never covered your back. So you enter in your driveway, you're oblivious, you're busy on your phone, you're busy, I returned from my journey overseas, I'm tired. No, but your whole 2 weeks, trips, your passports, everything that you had in your vehicle is gone just for that 5 seconds of negligence. And a person who's fast, who's got a purposeful walk, who's aggressive, who's alert, he's got eye contact, he's a hard person to mug. So even a thief wants an easy target. So are you a person who's drawing this evil? So if you display your wealth on your wrist with the fancy Rolexes, etc., so the Rolex gang will identify this person. They may even storm the house in the middle of the night because they know they're going to get a lot of Rolexes. So some people wear fake Rolexes, but you've compromised your life on a $5 or $10 watch. So We need to do a risk analysis, and that's very important. We have to leave our homes. This is the real world. But in the real world as well, the intelligent prepare. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq of making amal. The amal for today is that we need to seek amal that will perpetuate even after our death. إِنَّ مِمَّا يَلْحَقِ الْمُؤْمِنِ مِنْ أَمَلِهِ وَحَسَنَاتِهِ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهِ عِلْمًا أَلَّمَهُ وَنَشَرَهُ. So amongst those action which will join a person, يَلْحَقُ الْمُؤْمِنِ, it will join a person after his death, is knowledge which he learned, he taught, and he spread that knowledge. وَوَلَدًا صَالِحًا تَرَكَهُ, a pious offspring which he left. أو مُصْحَفًا وَرَّثَهُ, a Quran which he left in inheritance. أو مَسْجِدًا بَنَاهُ, he built a masjid. أو بَيْتًا لِبْنِ السَّبِيلِ بَنَاهُ, or a house for a traveler. أو نَهْرًا أَجْرَاهُ, or a source of water. He has created the flow, a river, a stream, a borehole, a well. أو صَدَقَةً أَخْرَجَهَا مِنْ مَالِهِ فِي صِحَّتِهِ وَحَيَاتِهِ, or charity which he has given from his wealth while he was hale and healthy. تَلْحَقُهُ بَعْدَ مَوْتِهِ, these rewards will join him after death. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ.